slap on the pancake makeup because we get to sit down with Neil Gaiman, writer of Mirror Mask, Anansi Boys, The Sandman, and probably everything else you love.
Jealous?
Plus, Chris Gore told us Tuesdays just weren't big enough for his DVD reviews, so he made up the word DVD Tuesday instead. He's a powerful man. And our hottest girl of MySpace search continues. Two girls enter, one girl leaves, and everyone feels kind of dirty for watching. And now it's the program that ruined your birthday party. Yeah, it's Attack of the Show.
Pick up on this.
Welcome to the show where two people clap on a couch and everybody stares at them awkwardly behind the cameras.
But we're so good looking.
We are, especially, yes. I like this. Did you break your back carrying that down the mountain?
A little Brokeback Mountain.
A little bit. And the boots, too. Show them off. Go ahead. Rock them.
That's how I roll.
Today there's more than just Will's attire. We have writer and geek to, he's a god to all geeks.
Yes, really.
There's no other way to say it. It's Neil Gaiman. He's on the show. He's going to talk about his new movie, Mirror Mask, coming out.
Yep.
And, of course, The Anansi Boys, which is his latest book. Cannot wait to grill him. Everybody has been in a three-quarter perspective, dimly lit frenzy on their Live Journal pages.
That's all well and good, Kevin. Yeah. But we have something really big on this show today. MySpace Girl of the Week battle.
That's true. That is true. It is
the
another...
lovely Lisa is back.
Lisa is back. And
we have a challenger.
We do?
Yes, the lovely Kim. Are you excited?
What's going on, ladies? They're over there. They're hanging out. It's good. We got a really good challenge, and I can't spoil it. I can't say what it is, but I must say it is going to be phenomenal.
It's
going to
be fantastic. I'm very excited.
It is TiVo worthy, my friend.
Yes, it is.
So, boop, 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 away. Boop, boop. But before we get into that,
thumbs up.
Either I'm having a stroke or my information sense is tingling.
What is that?
Like a book that sings and dances and imparts valuable life lessons, it's The Feed. The nominations for the 78th Annual Academy Awards were announced today. And Blah 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 beat out Blah Blah with 8 nominations. But more importantly, the animation category is heated this year, with computer animated films surprisingly taking a back seat to the likes of Corpse Bride, Wallace and Gromit, and Howl's Moving Castle. We, of course, are only watching to see if Batman Begins scores in the only category it's nominated in, Best Cinematography. Why the snub, Academy? Why? Speaking of meaningless media events, President Bush will deliver the State of the Union address tonight. Already the pundits and the drunkards, sorry, that's actually redundant, are setting up their snarky little games. Comedian Will Durst has a drinking game up on the Mother Jones blog encouraging people to drink every time, say, Bush mentions national security. Similarly, the Huffington Post has a game called 9/11 Beat the Clock, which is asking viewers to guess how long into the address we get before Bush references 9/11. So play along at home. It's fun for the whole family. In related booze news, the University of Massachusetts is cracking down on alcohol abuse. The school is banning any and all drinking games, as well as limiting the use of taps or funnels in large gatherings of people on campus. You know what happens there. This joins those other unenforceable rules like not sleeping with your professor to improve your grades or amateur athletes playing for free. Now, I've half a mind to show you some women wrestling in their underwear from the 70s and or 80s. Of course, I'd never dare tell you where to find such tawdry whimsies. But if you were to Google certain search terms like, apartment plus house plus wrestling, there's no telling what you might find. That's all I'm saying. Yeah, so remember yesterday when we told you to go to trackmanianations.com and download that demo? About that, turns out the demo is loaded with spyware. Who knew? Certainly not us. Speaking of which, Starforce, which is a software that severely limits the copying or distribution of games, is allegedly suing Boing Boing because the blog referred to Starforce as malicious malware. Hopefully that fight will distract you all from our faux pas. Did it? Yeah. Users are starting to find ways around Google's censorship in China. They've begun using different spellings of, say, Tiananmen Square to get the results that they're seeking. Unfortunately, there's still no clever hack for random home raids and imprisonment. And finally, a site called NoPityShirts.com is offering a selection of witty tees for the handicapped. Sporting slogans like, "Do I have to get up?" or "Keep staring, I might do a trick," and "Yes, I'm still in pain," they make great gifts for that special someone. And you have my permission to punch any hipster who wears one, ironically. And now back, and better than ever, some stories that could be summed up entirely through their headlines. PSP firmware has been conclusively hacked. Online music source Napster allegedly in talks with Google. Actress Natasha Lyonne is missing again. The Rock to star in a remake of the Clint Eastwood film Every Which Way But Loose. Sarah Silverman and Rob Schraub's TV project has been greenlit. And there's the feed. Are you happy now?
The feed is brought to you by Oxy Acne Solutions. Oxy helps keep acne from landing on your face.
Obviously, State of the Union address on everybody's mind. Yep. I know we've all been in heated discussions about what will be said later on tonight.
Sure. Are you going to watch?
No.
See, that's the thing. No one's going to watch. No one really, I mean, the only reason people watch is to laugh at the president or to play drinking games. No one really cares.
It's, I'm going to be playing drinking games.
Yeah, so, yeah
I mean,
too.
That's fun. Yeah.
It's hard to muster up a reason to watch it. In fact, I had to go straight to the source for some shred of any sort of reason to actually tune in. I want to know, why should I be watching?
You have such great connections.
Yeah, I want to know. So joining us live from Washington, D.C. is the president's very own Spinbot.
Spinbot,
are you there, sir?
Thank you, Kevin. It is nice to be here.
It's nice to have you here, Spinbot. Let me cut right to the chase. Tell me, why the hell should we actually watch the State of the Union address? Is it to hear Bush feebly defend domestic spying?
I believe you mean the terrorist surveillance program. It's nothing to worry about. When your mom checks in on you at night, do you call her a spy?
What? Look, Spinbot, listen, like the rest of the country, I'm tired of being lied to. You know, during last year's State of the Union, Bush was talking about this Clean Skies Initiative and No Child Left Behind Act, which, I mean, both of them did exactly the opposite.
Kevin, those are not lies. The president has to speak in code, like the show Lost. You like that show, right?
Yes, I like that show, Spinbot, but come on now, seriously, code?
The terrorists are listening. Shh. They hate our freedom.
All right, listen, Spinbot, I'm just saying that I don't think people are going to tune into the speech to hear Bush use the war on terror to justify any more sweeping domestic programs. I mean, there's absolutely no reason for anybody like us to watch.
The White Stripes are opening.
No, they're not, Spinbot.
With Death Cab for Cutie.
All right, that's enough. Thank you, Spinbot.
And I mean, Fleetwood Mac will be there. Kids love the Mac.
Kids don't love the Mac, Spinbot. That's ridiculous. Still not a solid reason to actually tune in.
I feel like Spinbot's just talking in circles.
That's what he does.
It's spin.
Politics,
spin.
Man.
Oh, politics.
It's a clever name. Yeah. Something that people do want to watch, though, and we found this over time with our extensive research. Oh, I have it, and it's on today's show.
It's good.
It's the MySpace girls.
Yes.
They're in the chat room, folks.
Oh,
there
I love
they are.
These girls.
Last week's MySpace girl, Lisa, is there defending her title of MySpace Girl of the Week. Lisa, how are you?
Hi, Lisa.
Good. Hi.
You look nice and comfy there on that little love sack.
I am.
And you having fun with the chatters today?
Oh, yeah.
All right. Well, you have a challenger, my friend.
Know.
It's the woman you voted on at home, ladies and gentlemen. There's Kim. Kim, how's the nice wooden stool treating you?
Oh, it's unbelievably comfy.
Good. Good to hear.
Believe it or not.
I'm glad.
Yeah.
We went out of our way to make you as uncomfortable as possible, so I guess we
felt
miserable.
Well, she is. I mean, she's got shoes to fill. As a challenger, you know,
you can't always have the love sack, but she's going to compete. In fact, there's a challenge going on today to see who will get the title, and more importantly, who's going to come back next week. It's going to be good.
And sit in the love sack.
Yes, and sit in the love sack. It's
good
going
luck,
to be
girls.
Really, really good.
Be
and
nice.
We're taking your calls. Taking your calls for writer Neil Gaiman. The number is 800-839-7880. And you can email us through our web form at attackoftheshow.com/askus. And you can chat in our IRC chat room as well. Just go to chat.g4tv.com. But coming up after the break, Sandman creator and general god amongst men, Neil Gaiman, joins us. So go ahead and touch up your black nail polish and hurry right on back.
On in Portuguese, it means cottage cheese. I ain't telling lies, I'm talking about your thighs.
Two words deflate any argument against the artistic merit of comic books. Neil Gaiman. Of course, he's also an accomplished novelist and filmmaker. He's even listed in the Dictionary of Literary Biography, get this, as one of the top 10 living postmodern writers. That's right, I'm going to sit up straight for this interview. Neil, welcome to the show. Normally I slouch and I'm like, you're top 10 postmodern writers that's still alive.
Actually, I think since they wrote that article, two or three of them have died. So I'm probably now one
You're probably in the top seven.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Keep on breathing.
Not a day goes by that I don't sit up and think I'm one of the top 10 postmodern writers. I wonder what that means.
I don't know.
You don't know, it was in the prompter,
and I read it. It sounded good, though.
It does. It sounds really good.
Print that, frame it, put it on your wall. People would be impressed.
If only they handed out a certificate. So, yes, I am. I think it means I write all kinds of stuff.
You do write, and that's why I hate to grill you, but it's the new thing whenever a writer comes on television to get to the hard-hitting stuff. Mr. Nancy, really a spider god?
I made
Was
that
he
up.
Really?
I made it all up. The entirety of A Nancy Boy is my last novel. I know people thought that it was like a completely true story about this guy who discovered his dad was a god, and then that he had a brother he didn't know, and it's fiction.
I feel duped, Mr. Gaiman. I feel duped.
Well, obviously, we're offering you, you know, you can have your money back. No, you can't.
No, I can't. No. What are you saying?
Actually, when I was in England, American Gods, the novel before A Nancy Boys, they had this thing, this big sticker on the book, which said, as good as Stephen King, or your money back. And
wow.
It was this thing where you could send back the book and the receipt if you didn't think it was as good as Stephen King, which is kind of odd because it's nothing at all like Stephen King.
Sure. Does it take that to hype a book these days? To put a sticker on it and say, look, take a risk on these words.
That was what they did.
And give up 30 minutes of your restroom time, you know.
We got one person writing in and saying he didn't want to give the book back, but could he have his money back anyway? And we had one person sending us a check for the cost of the book in addition, saying it was better than they thought they paid for and could they send us some more money.
And you had Stephen King writing under 13 different names saying, look, there's no way. Come on, man. What are you talking about?
Actually, Steve's been lovely, and he liked A Nancy Boys. He put it up on his website saying he thought it was excellent. So
tons of support for this book. Some people are calling A Nancy Boys, they're calling it a bit of a sequel, but I don't see it as that. I see it more of like a spin-off book, if you will.
Yeah, it's more like, I mean, American Gods was this great, big, serious, sensible novel that I did, and it won all the serious awards and the Nebula and the Hugo and the Stoker and all that. A Nancy Boys is funny. And it's set in the same kind of universe as American Gods, which is to say one in which gods do wander around and you can bump into them. But it's the idea of A Nancy Boys was just to write a book that people would close at the end with a smile on their face.
Sure, sure. And we just saw some of Sandman here, which, I mean, really, for graphic novels, this set the standard, this set the bar. And do you think that, you know, something like Sandman is still influencing graphic novels to this day?
Well, I think that the important graphic novels of the period that Sandman came out of, Watchmen, The Dark Knight Returns, Art Spiegelman's Mouse, Sandman itself, are still influencing people, not because they're seminal works from 20-odd years ago, but because they're current works. It's the stuff, if you go into a Barnes & Noble and see what's out there, that's what you're going to be picking up.
Sure.
So they are peculiarly current for things that at the time Alan Moore and Frank Miller and I assumed were pretty damn disposable. We figured they'd be forgotten in a year because comics were.
But not forgotten by the large emo following that you have. A lot of the goth kids, the dressed in blacks, the painted fingernails, they really appreciate the Sandman.
Yes and no. I mean, yes, they do. But frankly, if you take a signing that I do, if we've got 500 people there, we probably have 3 or 4 goth kids.
Right.
Who look great and everybody remembers them, but we also have 3 or 4 grandmothers, and nobody goes, "Oh my God, you're writing for the grandmothers."
Sure,
you know?
Sure.
But the
grandmothers don't cut themselves in appreciation of the finishing of one of your works. That's
you
the
never
difference,
know.
So. Oh,
you
maybe
never,
they do. Maybe they do.
Those grandmothers, they just keep it quiet.
What are you reading today? Like, what do you actually pick up? Are there any graphic novels today that get you, or any comics?
Oh, sure. I love anything by Alan Moore. I will read anything Alan Moore writes. If Alan Moore decided to start writing, you know, publishing his laundry lists, I would read them. Eddie Campbell. Eddie is a mad Scot currently living in Brisbane, Australia, drawing strange and beautiful, semi-autobiographical mostly stories, although he's probably most famous for From Hell.
This is all From Hell, right?
Both of those. That was the one place they collaborated, was on From Hell. You know, there are a couple of people, but I love reading comics. it's still one of those places that there's an amazing amount of life and fun and vibrancy.
Did you ever imagine that you'd be saying that, you know, later on in life when you were, you know, 9 years old ripping open comics or 12 years old at the shop? Would you ever think you'd be admitting that you enjoy reading comics? Like, it's okay, it's cool now, it's...
I always knew that I would cheerfully admit to reading comics.
Sure.
I mean, I used to have arguments. I was the kind of kid who'd have arguments with teachers who would explain that this was mind-rotting, negative calorie stuff that would destroy my mind. And I'm going, but I won the school English prize. Why can't I read it? I love this stuff. What I didn't expect was to find a world in which essentially we'd won. The world in which...
This is a brave new world now.
It's a very weird world, a world in which I went online the other day and sent me a note letting me know about the academic conference in California later this year on me. And you're going, and they said, are you going to write a paper? And it's like, no, it will be like working on my own autopsy. Of course not.
That's right. That's great.
But I love the fact that we have that world out there.
Sure.
I love the fact that we've got, you know, a world in which the amazing immediacy of things like blogs, again, has changed everything.
You've embraced them quite a bit. You're a big-time blogger now.
I'm a big-time blogger. I didn't expect to be. I started in 2001, February 2001, and back then, so I was one of the earliest bloggers.
Back then it was keeping a web page, but now it's got a buzzword and everybody's doing it.
It was me, there was a handful of Tyrannosaurus Rexes blogging, an Iguanodon, and...
Literally with the tiny T-Rex arms, trying to pound the home run.
Absolutely, and doing okay. I mean, they've all died out now.
Couple
I'm still doing it, except actually for today. I didn't get to announce this thing on my blog because it's down for 2 days because we're migrating the data, whatever that means, to the new incarnation of neilgaiman.com.
Fear not. We will do you one better. We will give you a video that you can podcast. You can be part of that.
I will happily. If you give me a podcast thing, I can tell people about it and they will love it.
I'll do that for you if you tell me about Mirror Mask and about how this project came about, because you were commissioned essentially to create the next Labyrinth or the next Dark Crystal, right?
Yeah, I mean, that was basically how it went. It was me and Dave McKean. I got a phone call from Lisa Henson, who is Jim Henson's daughter, and she said, look, Sony have discovered, they've sort of noticed that Labyrinth and Dark Crystal, these fantasy films that Henson's made back in the 80s, which were thought to have been flops, have gone on to become incredibly popular over the years on DVD and video. So they want us to make a film like that. Mm-hmm. And I said, great, is there a catch? And she said, well, only one. We have $4 million... to make it with. And I laughed at her.
Right.
And then she said, no, I've got an idea. I want Dave McKean to do it, because she'd seen some of Dave's short films, which he'd quite literally made in his mother's barn for nothing. And she loved them and said, could Dave do it? So Dave and I went away for about a week to the Jim Henson family house in London. And Dave had a very specific idea of what he could do and how he could create that look and that feel and do something like that for $4 million.
Anybody who's seen it knows how incredible it looks. What's
fun is now is it's coming out next week on DVD, and so, which was what it was always sort of meant for, is something you can immerse yourself in, you can rewatch, you can pick things up, you can sit there and watch the strange room full of music box dolls turning our heroine
Don't spoil too much. I know everybody out there is going to grab it.
Okay.
We're all big fans. Neil, thank you so much for coming on.
You are so welcome. That was
really
fun.
Really appreciate it, my friend. Be sure to head on over to Neil's blog. That's right. He is still a blogger at neilgaiman.com. Maybe there'll be a podcast. Who knows? And Mirror Mask is available on DVD this Valentine's Day, February 14th. I didn't get to ask a ton of stuff, but you get the chance. He's taking phone calls, so stay tuned, little doggies. You can be a couch potato anywhere in the world. Up next, a magic silver box that lets you take your TV with you. I'm not kidding. Stay tuned. When Blake Krikorian told me what the sling box could do, I was like, no. And he was like, yeah. So I was like, dude, I want one. And here he is, the CEO of Sling Media, everybody. Blake, welcome to the show.
Hey, thank you.
First of all, a congratulations is in order, my friend. I should have rolled out a cake or some party horns or something for you.
Indeed, you can actually have some lunch today.
So. $46.6 million in funding and from investors for Sling Media, right?
Yeah, exactly. So we're pretty fired up about it today.
So you planned the Vegas trip already, I'm assuming?
Oh, yeah.
You can't pick the escort girls? What are you guys doing? You have $46.6 million to work with now.
Well, now I get to keep a job for a few more months. So, we're really excited about it. I mean, we have some great investors we brought into, right, with like Liberty and EchoStar and Allen & Company and Goldman Sachs. It just helps us take the next step to achieve our vision. I mean, we're still these underdogs. I mean, we're trying to deliver products to the end consumer through retail, which most people think is just insane for a startup. But, you know, so far, so good. And now hopefully we can make some more products and refine our existing products and just delight the consumer more and more.
Everybody who's anybody at this office knows about the Slingbox. They probably have one, maybe two, sometimes 12. And they know that, I mean, for those who haven't heard of it yet, basically a Slingbox lets me take my media, my television, my movies, anything that I plug into the device and pretty much broadcast it anywhere over the internet. I just need an internet connection, and then I needed a computer.
Correct.
But now you guys, since CES, have announced a product that changes all that, because this is a Trio 700 running Slingbox on a mobile platform.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
No trickery here. This is really running.
That's the real stuff.
So is this the next step for Sling?
Yeah, it's the next step for the Slingbox itself and Slingbox customers. I mean, the great thing is that the customers we have now are going to be able to enjoy this. Our whole goal when we set out to make the Slingbox product line was to turn every single display that we as consumers interface with, whether it's our living room TV, our laptop, our PC, or our phone, or PDA, we want to turn that into our living room TV.
Sure, I've got the screen with me at all times. Give me something to watch.
Exactly. Any screen should be your living room TV. And so we, initially, as you said, we targeted laptops and PCs. Mm-hmm. Now we're coming out with a client that works with existing Slingboxes. So Slingbox owners, today will be able to benefit from this.
Right.
And Windows Mobile PDAs and smartphones like the Trio 700. Motorola Q phone, Dell Axum, iPad, so forth.
Nice. Well, it probably won't work on my Giornata from 1994, though, I'm assuming.
Probably all not.
Right. It'll work on your Velo 1,
though. But anyway, it's a long story.
No, that's good. I like that. And it complements TiVo nicely. I mean, it's like you're running.
Yeah, it really does. Actually, to really trip out here, I don't know if we can zoom in on this guy.
Oh, of course, we can do anything here.
I'm actually watching. This is my living room TV right now, watching G4.
Yeah, there we are, 10 seconds ago.
Pretty trippy.
I look adorable, by the way, even on a mobile platform.
I'm going to tuck in that stomach a little bit. So anything that you can do. In fact, I can even go and connect into my control my TiVo. I don't know if you guys can see that or not.
Oh, absolutely.
But, I'm controlling my TiVo. I can go ahead and, move around a little bit.
So actually navigate your home
navigate
media
the
box,
TiVo, go
live,
back to live TV, whatever. Anything you can do from your living room couch, you can do here. Of course, you don't need to have a TiVo.
Sure.
I'm a huge TiVo fan, so I love it. You can use analog, cable, satellite, whatever you want.
That's great. And now if I'm Mobi TV or if I'm VCast, watch out. Pay $15 and get a 3-second clip of your favorite show. Am I quaking in my boots? I mean.
Oh, geez, I don't know. We have love for everybody, man. So, for the mobile operators, it's great because, there's still the monthly. You have to have a monthly data plan, And so you just get more value out of that data plan that you're paying for, not just email and web browsing, but now. Your living room TV.
Right. Well, I love that the content itself is free, and I love that it works with existing Slingboxes. We're big fans here, Blake.
Right on. Hey,
thanks a lot.
Coming
on, showing it off. We appreciate it. All right. Your TV told me that, we were speaking in private. It wants a Slingbox. It really does. So head on over to slingmedia.com to get all the latest info on the Slingbox itself. Now, which is sexier, I ask? Our latest MySpace girl or DV Tuesday's Chris Gore, huh? I'm going to bow out of that poser and just ask you to stay tuned. You guys figure it out.
The line forms here for more Attack of the Show. So, do you like MySpace girls? You want to get in some Neil Gaiman on the horn? Yeah? Then park it, partner, because that's what's coming up in the next half hour. But first, there are DVD do's, there are DVD don'ts, and there are DVD do's days. Chris Gore, the man who's going to help me out on DVD Tuesday, back
right.
with me again. We're coming back from illness. That's
yes, exactly. I brought back a T-shirt and a cold.
Me too.
Yeah,
I didn't get a
sick,
T-shirt, though. Darn it.
Yeah.
All right, so let's get right into it on DVD Tuesday today. This one is Steven Soderbergh's Bubble. Okay. Little different than other movies.
That's right. Now, this film, Steven Soderbergh, of course, Oscar-winning director. Sure. This film is made with non-actors, people who aren't professional actors. It's a murder story set at a doll factory in the Midwest, and he recruited these people just by interviewing them and finding out about their actual lives, then wove those into a story. And what was kind of fascinating about it is the way he directed the film was a lot like how they did Blair Witch Project. He'd throw these real people into situations, not tell them what was going to happen. He'd tell certain of them to do certain things. So the surprise that the characters felt in the film was real because the actors felt
there's
that
like
way.
Mandatory ad-libbing going on. What about like behind the scenes? It seems like the kind of project that would have good behind the scenes.
Good behind the scenes. It's shot on HD, and this is the first film from 2929 Entertainment. They're putting out movies on HDNet, also on in theaters at the Landmark Theaters and on DVD all at the same time. It's a brand new concept.
Some people are all up in arms about it.
Some people are up in arms about it, but this is a great debut feature. It's a small independent film, fantastic, tons of extras on it, two commentary tracks, lots of behind the scenes, fascinating. And also, it's one of those things where it's like you see this movie and you go, you know what? I could make a film like that. And what's great about Soderbergh is he doesn't hold anything back. He will give away every filmmaking trick secret. He'll talk about where he stole things for his filmmaking, and he's just very bold.
So the bottom line is this is a freaking buy, man.
Bottom line, this is not only a buy, but like, see it any other way. See it on HDNet, see it on the theaters, get the DVD. It's fantastic.
All right, cool. Well, we're off and running. Next up, Corpse Bride.
Corpse Bride just turned out today, nominated for Best Animated Feature.
Yes,
Oscar.
Which is good.
Good animation. It's just so funny. There's such a short list of animated features. I'd say it's kind of easy to get nominated. I mean, I was not a big fan of this film. I think Nightmare Before Christmas was so much better, and this just does not even come close to how great that film was.
Are you talking story? You talking quality, visual quality?
I mean, on all levels. I mean, it just didn't have that cast of characters. Who do I identify with? I'm not sure, you know?
The corpse or the brat,
Yeah, I mean, I love the look, but it looks a lot like Nightmare, and I thought Nightmare was done better.
What about the special features?
Not a lot on it, no commentary.
Really?
Just a few behind the scenes, but they really feel salesy, you know? The story is, I mean, I don't need to be sold. I own the DVD, you know, presuming I actually own it.
And I guess the technique, I mean, if it's so similar to Nightmare Before Christmas, we sort of know how that was already made.
Right,
so where's the technique really taking us to the next level?
Yeah.
Bottom line here?
Bottom line, this is a pass. I know I hate to say this, but it's a pass. You know, for me, it just didn't hold up. I wanted more.
Chris, I mean, I'm bummed, but at least you're speaking the truth.
I am.
At least you're speaking the truth and saving me some money.
Yeah.
Okay, now, you've got something extra that you brought with you.
Yes, I did.
It happens to be your own movie.
My own film is out on DVD.
What I'm going to do, though.
Oh, okay, what?
You can only plug it for a certain amount of time, because you know Chris.
So
we're going to put 1 minute on the clock.
Okay, I get 1 minute.
And when I say go, you get 1 minute, all right? On your marks, get set.
Okay, my big fat independent movie is a comedy in the vein of Scary Movie. If you love indie film like I do, you're going to find tons of jokes about all kinds of inappropriate things. If you like farts, this is like a love letter to independent film in the form of a fart joke. There are two editions out right now. There's the R-rated version, but you can also get the double disc unrated version. It's got tons of special features on it.
45.
And there's two commentary tracks, including one where I got the actors completely plastered drunk. So the actors are drunk talking crap about me. It's awesome. And then there's even a track called the Theatrical Experience. We can watch the movie as if you're watching it in a movie theater. So you hear babies crying and bottles and people eating popcorn. It's funny. And then there's even Easter eggs on every single page
down and to the right.
You'll find all
three,
the Easter eggs. You got to get it.
One,
it's my movie.
And time. That was amazing.
Is that good?
Give it up for Chris. You are such a good talker.
Thank you very much.
You got another clap in the background there. Someone's like, yeah, that's pretty good.
Get my movie. It doesn't suck.
Aw, Chris.
Awesome. The best I can say about it.
You're the best, man. Good job.
Cool. Thank you.
Good work. You can visit filmthreat.com or chrisgore.com. Go on. Make your vote count and get my big fat independent movie to look at. Coming up after the break, it's you on the phone with Neil Gaiman. Hell yeah. Plus the gals of MySpace also. It's all when Attack of the Show returns.
We'll be right back.
Kevin didn't get a chance to ask you during your interview earlier in the show, but what is going on with this Stardust project of yours?
Stardust is, it's being directed by Matthew Vaughn.
Okay.
Who did a film called Layer Cake, which was a crime thing, and was actually, he was the producer of Lock, Stock, and Two Smoking Barrels
sure.
and Snatch.
So that's a good start.
It's kind of fun, although this is very different to both of those. And it starts shooting in England in April. It's being made at Paramount, and they're casting it right now. I was down on the Paramount lot this morning.
Oh, boy.
Running the camera while they were auditioning beautiful ladies to play the part of the star.
Rough life, huh, Neil?
Really hard.
Yeah, tough. All right, so now we know a little bit more about Stardust. You ready to take a phone call from one of our audience members? All right, let's start off with Frank, who joined us on the phone from Castleberry, Florida. Hey, Frank, you there?
Hey.
You got a question for Neil?
Yeah, I wanted to ask about Beowulf and Grendel.
The Beowulf film. Right.
I guess he's asking about the status.
Yeah. So what's happening? Well, it's kind of weird because
okay.
Beowulf is a film that I wrote with Roger Avery.
Mm-hmm.
And the performances were captured, I think would be the technical way of saying it, last October. And it's our retelling of the story of Beowulf. The one that people slept through in high school. And it stars Anthony Hopkins and Angelina Jolie and Crispin Glover as Grendel. Angelina Jolie is Grendel's mother, of course.
Mm.
John Malkovich is in it. Ray Winston plays...
My gosh.
Beowulf.
Everyone's in it.
But what's fun about it is that this is the sort of version 3.0 of what Polar Express was version 1.0 of.
Oh, okay.
It's the full performance capture, mm-hmm. costumes, it's everybody's actually done their bit. Watching them acting was rather like watching the cast of Tron performing Shakespeare. It was really peculiar. And my daughter wanted to know if Angelina Jolie was as beautiful as she looks on the photos when I met her. And I had to explain, I have no idea, because she had 150 tiny dots,
yeah.
plus little things
yeah.
capturing eye movement
right,
on
right.
her face. But now, it's not going to come out until 2007. The movie, all of the performances have now been captured.
Sure. And then there's all this other work to do.
Now so. It has to get made in the computer.
So everything's cool, but you got to wait a little bit longer.
Got to wait. It'll be fall of 2007, and then it will be out.
And it'll be wonderful.
I hope so. I have no idea. It's the strangest thing. I wrote this film. I've seen bits of it being filmed. Mm-hmm. I have no idea what it's going to look like.
Well, Frank, you got your answer, sort of. Beowulf, it's coming to you, man. It'll be there, 2007. Now, thank you, Neil, very much. Now, Kevin's with two girls and no supervision. A chill just went up my spine.
Now it's time for the MySpace Girl of the Week. You know, we trolled MySpace to find those special women who challenge and intrigue us. And then we make them do humiliating things. And then you at home get to vote on who stays and who gets replaced, so it's pretty much, it's a win-win all around. Lisa is our MySpace girl from last week. Lisa, welcome back.
Hey, thank you.
Congrats on the win against Will in the hot dog eating contest.
Thank you.
That was impressive. How was that experience for you?
Oh, God, it was horrible.
I bet.
I got to tell you, you did a horrible job holding my hair back.
Thank you.
I had hair in my face.
It's,
But it's okay.
I like
it's okay.
You go home after an appearance on Attack of the Show. What happens to your MySpace?
Oh, my goodness. It was flooding with messages and friend requests, and it took me about 2 hours to get through all of them, because I read every single one.
Wow.
And I tried my best to reply to every single one, too.
Sure. That lasts for about 3 hours, and then you just
give
up.
Yeah, for about 3 hours, and I was like, okay, I'm tired. But so I pressed home, or, you know, to refresh the page, another 200-something messages, another 200 friend requests, and...
It's nice to feel that, though,
isn't it?
Nice. It's flattering that people out there
care. A lot of support from everyone.
But this week, you're on the line. You're defending that.
Oh,
I mean,
you've got to
hold on to that attention.
I really do.
You're going up against Kim, and I'm curious, Lisa, what makes you think you should be our MySpace Girl of the Week?
Well, I'm not your typical MySpace girl. Mm-hmm. I do play video games, for those of you who don't believe me.
Okay, plays games.
Yeah, I watched G4, been a fan of Attack of the Show. You know, come on. I know who
Leroy
Jenkins is.
That's not going to get you in this crowd, by the way.
Oh,
it's not
okay.
people like us. But okay,
okay.
we get
right.
it, Lisa, and I'm
yeah.
glad you're back.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
But now it's Kim's turn. Kim, welcome to the show. Congrats on getting voted on by the viewers at home.
Thank you.
Did you ever think, MySpace profile would get you on television or?
No way. I just couldn't even imagine that it would bring me here.
Now, what's, I mean, do you get the crazy stalkers on the MySpace as well? Do you get the guys trying to hit on you or ask you out on dates, et cetera?
So far, I've only gotten about one. Okay. Other than that, they're all really supportive, all really cool and down to earth.
Now, that one creepy guy stands out, which I like. What made him so special to you?
He had a crazy fetish with feet and peanut butter. I don't know about that one.
Okay. Yeah. I'm going to just let that marinate for a second. That's good. Now, on your MySpace profile, it lists some of your interests.
Yeah.
And those are, it's outdoors. You like the outdoors. You like to dance.
Definitely.
Meeting new people, which is nice. These all seem very standard. That's fine. I approve of them. Then there's fire. Fire, Kim. Are you a bit of a pyro?
A little more than a bit. I enjoy fire a lot. It's fantastically fun. Actually.
Do you enjoy it in the same way that the guy enjoys like feet and peanut butter, or is this a different thing?
It's a little different. It's a little just exhilarating, I guess. You have fun like manipulating the fire, creating fireballs and throwing them and just trying not to catch too many things on fire.
Throwing fireballs. Is this like a Street Fighter 2 thing?
Or? Yeah, kinda. It's like you take a lighter and you hold it in your hand and then you light it and you throw it.
Oh wow. Kids, don't pay any attention to anything you just heard, by the way. That sounds dangerous.
Yeah.
But from the fire to the video game things, Lisa says she's a bit of a gamer. You've got a video game on your profile.
Definitely.
What's Zelda doing on there?
Zelda is my all-time favorite. He is the one. Zelda and Link are the ones that got me into gaming in the first place. It was my number one. I'm Zelda's number one fan.
All right. So you're not just saying that you're not one of those people who says, I play video games. Listen, I play Pac-Man and Grand Theft Auto.
No way.
You throw out the buzzword games. You actually game.
I actually game.
Mm. All right. Well, now the real question is, do you think you're worthy of replacing Lisa as our MySpace Girl of the Week, Kim?
I think so.
Oh.
Definitely.
That was rather confident. Oh. Kim, what makes you say that?
Because I'm a gamer. Hardcore. Down to the core.
A real gamer.
Yeah, a real gamer.
Hmm. This is interesting because Lisa supposedly is a real gamer as well. Kim, Lisa, what do you have to say about that?
Well, we'll just have to see how it goes down.
Yeah, yeah. Would both of you be willing to perhaps, I don't know, fight for the title?
Definitely.
Think I can handle that?
Oh, yes.
Okay. All right. Done. After the break, folks, Lisa and Kim will compete to determine who stays and who goes. You guys should talk trash right now. Go for it. Stick around. Right. It'll all be worth it for at least one person, or maybe two, and, well, the people in this studio. You'll see. Just watch this commercial.
You're watching G4, the number one podcasted network in America.
Wall-to-wall game reviews.
Always expect the unexpected.
Go to iTunes or G4TV.com for details.
On the next attack of the show, CFQ magazine editor Sean Jordan tells us when to keep the channel surfing and when to stop and gawk. Plus, we'll take a look at your user-created shrine submissions, then write about you in a sociology journal. And you think Star Wars is over? Well, think again. We'll show off the new Star Wars real-time strategy game, Star Wars Empire at War. All that on the next attack of the show. Now, it's a battle for ultimate supremacy, a feat of skill to determine who will be the best of the best, who will be the hottest of the hot, who will become MySpace Girl of the Week. Yes, competing this week for the title. She's into TiVo, panda bears, and eating. She's reigning champion, Lisa! Challenging her for the title. She's into kung fu movies, caves, and fire. It's Kim! Ladies, the rules are simple. Very simple rules here. We've made them. Force your opponent out of the circle to score a point. The first MySpace girl to get 3 points, or the person with the highest point total when our 1 minute timer runs out, is the winner. You understand me?
Yes.
Fantastic. Are you ready, Lisa?
Yes.
Ready up, my lady. Fantastic. Kim, are you ready? Assume your position as well. We sumo on sumo. One, two, sumo! Fantastic technique! Lisa's out! Ladies, separate! Separate! 1 point for Kim! Nothing for Lisa! One, two, sumo! I like this angle! Take your time! Seriously, really work this one out! Very close! Foot is out! Ladies are down! Back to your spots! Lisa takes that one! 1 point, Lisa! Ladies, reset! One, two, sumo! Oh, that was a grunt and a half! Lisa's almost done! Lisa's fighting! Oh, my lord! This is kind of hot! Kim takes that round there! Completely deflated! We have time for one more!
Risa, are you hurt?
No.
Can you continue?
Yes.
One, two, sumo! Oh, this is, we're almost out of time, two. Time is up, ladies! Hold on, hold it, stay right there. Stay right there. Stay right there. Okay, now you can move on. That was my moment, thank you. Fantastic, we have a winner, ladies and gentlemen, Lisa. I'm so sorry, my darling.
It's okay.
You did a valiant effort. Very well done. Ladies and gentlemen, Kim is our MySpace Girl of the Week! Congratulations, Kim. There is yet more Attack of the Show on the way. Can you believe it? Emails, chat questions after this. You want one more for just for kicks? Go for it, Sumo!
Attack of the Show, baby. Attack.
Kim looks mighty comfy on that love sack.
Oh, yeah.
It's going to be hard to say goodbye to Lisa, though.
That was television gold right there.
That's what we make here.
I have this urge to just pull your little...
You really should just get to the IRC chat.
All right. Paint It Black wants to know, how much longer till we become the slaves of robots? Interesting questions. Mm. Hard to answer, though.
I'd say the time is now.
I don't know. A week?
Nah, I'd give it maybe 6 months or so.
You ballparking? Yeah. I mean, notice we're not really that witty unless it's on the prompter, so I'd say we're pretty much slaves to the machine anyway.
Yes,
right?
We are, yes.
Sure.
The prompter machine.
Maybe the next question will be something we can answer.
Give us funny words.
That guy asks, Kevin, what is your favorite reaction to awkward pauses?
Oh, I like giving this one. Don't...
Sorry. Hey,
that's real.
All right, I don't know if we have any more time.
Do we have time?
I don't think so.
We don't. Here, just go back to the awkward pause.
Exactly.
Thanks to our guests, Neil Gaiman, Blake Krikorian, Chris Gore, and of course, our MySpace girls, Lisa and Kim.
Woo!
Good work, ladies. Now, coming up next on G4, we've got enough Star Trek to satisfy even that guy in your office with the limited edition Galactic Federation inhaler. Yeah, that one. Got back-to-back episodes of Star Trek The Next Generation nightly at 8 p.m.